Hi everyone, welcome to the Innovation Evangelist podcast. This is my name is Tom Raftery. I'm the Innovation Evangelist for SAP, but with me today I have another Innovation Evangelist who also works for SAP. Timo, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hello, everyone. So, as Tom said, I'm a global innovation evangelist for SAP, 28 years with the company, with a background in data and analytics. And my job is to go around the world talking to audiences about all of the really cool stuff that SAP is working on.
Nice. And you've beat me there. You're 28 years with SAP. I'm 2 years with SAP. So you've a lot more experience in this than I do. So talking about all the cool stuff, this is the whole function of this podcast is to, bring up to the surface the cool innovations that are happening globally. So I thought, who better to have on the show than another innovation evangelist? And let's have a chat about that, Timo. What cool innovations have you seen recently that are really getting you excited?
All right. Well, since you asked me to prepare for this, I started like noting down ideas, and I've ended up with my top 10 things that I'm personally interested in.
Great.
So, should we just go through the list?
Let's
Does that
do it.
sound okay?
Yeah, it sounds
All
awesome.
right. So number one is a big one. This is a golden age for technology. Technology is clearly accelerating faster than it's ever been before. It's doing amazing things in every area of human existence. So all of that benefits should we, it's just a great opportunity to make the world better, but also I hope share those benefits equally so that everybody in the world is better off through technology. So I just wanted to start off with a big one. That is honestly why I enjoy my job so much, that ultimately I'm talking about something that really is making the world a better place, whether it's Internet of Things or nanotechnology and so on. So I just want to start it off with that one. Now, my background is analytics, so go ahead.
I often finish my talks saying that we have never, ever, ever had it this good, and we will never, ever, ever have it this bad again.
Well, let's hope
And
so. Let's hope so. Yeah. Does society go in cycles? That's an interesting philosophical question that hasn't really been we'll know in a few hundred years, except we won't know.
but you were saying, that we've ne computing has never been this fast before, and the kind of thing is it getting faster all the time, and will it never be this slow again? And what are the consequences of that?
Yeah, certainly. So, the exponential society and so on, there's lots of interesting things there. So my background is, like I said, data and analytics. So as I went down the list of things that I care about, it's mostly about data and analytics. And having said that everything's wonderful, there are still things that I'm concerned about. And so number two point is, I call it weaponized algorithmic addiction. So I believe it's a huge concern of society. So we've got this amazing technology, artificial intelligence, machine learning that can learn over time. And it really is allowing us to improve productivity in amazing ways. But it's also allowing us to take activities and truly maximize those activities. Now, sometimes those activities are not good things, like gambling. So, for example, people use analytics technology, machine learning predictive, to help ensure that gamblers spend as much time as possible at the gambling table. So they know, for example, if you lose a lot of money in a casino, one of our competitors has provided the analytics for a company that can help that gambling organization work out exactly what freebie to give you. It could be a meal, it could be a free ticket for a show, it could be something like something else to get you back into the gambling mood.
Wow.
So they really know how to push your buttons. So really you help algorithms and predictive used in ways that we ostensibly like or are good for us or we want. So it could be how often we check our Facebook page. It could be some, Candy Crush or some or Farmville or some other game on the internet. It could be how we obsessively cross-post things about some politician we don't like. But the algorithms behind the scenes, video games. There's lots and lots of really well-paid people that are making video games as addictive as possible for teenagers. And so that is a strong cause for concern.
I see that with my own kids. Fortnite's a huge example of that.
And again, I don't know. There's no easy answer on how to fix that. It's something that's always existed. It's not like addictive behavior is new, but we've just gotten better at helping people with their addictions, making it worse. So some of its business models, we might touch on it last time. So that's my second point. Third point, which kind of leads on, is asymmetric social warfare. So this is guerrilla war is about a much smaller force defending itself in a fight or a war against a vastly superior military force. And the statistics are amazing. So if you have two armies that are facing each other and one army is slightly larger than the other, the smaller army loses about the amount you'd expect. But when the opposing force is much, much, much smaller, they win far more often than they should do. If you look at the numbers, why? It's because of guerrilla warfare. They have to just throw away the rules of war and do something just completely different. Yeah. Now we're starting to see that because of these the power of these social weapons, we can start seeing that people are applying them to social wars and other forms of getting their opinion across. So an Anglo-Irishman, Jonathan Smith, you'll like this. So falsehood flies and the truth comes limping after it, 1710. These days, we typically say a lie can travel halfway around the world while the truth is still putting on its shoes. So what's great about Boson technology is we can get stuff out there, broadcast things to the world very easily and cheaply. The trouble is that lies are a lot more interesting than the truth most of the time. And so we're starting to see the consequences of that. I saw a lovely cartoon yesterday. It was a bunch of the death stereotype, you know, with the hood and the scythe. Yeah. So a bunch of them, like junior deaths, sitting around a table, and they're thinking about, you know, oh, you know, we're out of super viruses. You know, we're gonna really have to struggle to find a new one to kill lots of people, kill humanity. And then somebody says, oh, I know. Why don't we create a hoax about vaccines? And then the last part of the cartoon is it just says employee of the month in a death picture. So yeah, what better way to kill as many people as possible than inventing a lie about vaccines being worse for you than the diseases that they're fixing? And we're seeing this huge increase in measles, for example, in various pockets of places that don't. Always there's a nice thing about, you know, so 1960s teenagers sneak out for a smoke. 2019, they sneak out to get vaccinated. So, for example, another aspect of this, if you are a rogue nation, you want to destabilize some other country, then you'd almost be crazy not to invest in a little bit of money in pouring lies onto Facebook and social media, whether it's about the U.S. elections, the yellow vests, the gilets jaunes in France. I live in France. The Brexiteers in the U.K., independence for Catalonia, just whatever subject it is that you think could be destabilizing for a country. You'd be crazy not to put a little bit of money into that kind of asymmetric social guerrilla warfare. Mm. So again, it's innovation with strong consequences on society. How do we fix it? Don't know. Big issue. I think that's something that all of us who work in technology should look to help with. Number four, a little more positive for change, good, is predictive maintenance for people. So clearly, all of this great new technology is going to help just better care. You know, what works, what doesn't, we'll find out better because we've got better data to sift through. Much more opportunities for personalized care. You know, SAP, we're working on helping people on proteomics. Really cool use of SAP HANA in memory. Have to get the plugs in, you know, every now and again. But it is a really cool project where they can start. It's not just genomics and your DNA. It's also down to the proteins. That's about as much as I know. But anyway, personalized care based on exactly what you need for your type of cancer is on the horizon. So that's great. But then it's really going to be predictive maintenance for people. So the Apple Watch, for example, there's a whole bunch of stories about people detecting arrhythmia that they had no idea about, got it checked out, and they said, wow, yes, glad you came to see us because that was a heart attack in the making. We're both middle-aged men. Heart attacks are a huge cause of death for us. So the fact that these kinds of algorithms and data processing can help head off that kind of event, mm-hmm. if you get care within, even if it's 5-10 minutes earlier, that it can be enough to make the difference between life and death. So we're going to save hundreds or thousands of lives thanks to that. So that's good news. Also, mental health and suicide. I talked to the Harris Logic, Hudson Harris of Harris Logic, fantastic project they're doing using SAP predictive analytics. So basically, they have a huge amount of data on mental health care patients, the justice system, the health system, and so on, all completely GDPR, HIPAA compliant and everything. Sure. But they sift through that and detect the subtle signs that somebody with mental health issue might need some extra help. And so the health professionals can go in and ask them if they need help before they end up in the street or arrested or a jail or worse. So it really is helping avoid a worst of all world situation. And it turns out that it's a better healthcare, better for the patients, and it also saves a ton of money for the cities that they're working with. So just, you know, lovely win-win-win. It's actually a lot like Minority Report. Because they're actually detecting the chances of crimes in advance. But the good news is, instead of arresting them in advance, they go to them and say, how can we help? So it's a lovely one. Number five, innovation, AI ethics. So machine learning algorithms are really happy to replicate all of the bias that we humans have put into the original data set. So there's a very strong need for governance. We absolutely have to make sure that people remain firmly in charge. Algorithms are psychopaths. Yes. They're very strong, they're very powerful, but they have no notion of human existence or empathy, and so we need to guide them. We've always seen some lovely examples of algorithms that start gaming the system, for example. You know, with humans, right, you give people KPIs and say, hey, your bonus depends on this KPI, this indicator. Then there's lots of examples of how people do the wrong thing in order to hit their number. Yeah. Algorithms do it, but even faster and better. So there's these lovely situations where, you know, they try to set up the situation, but they coded it slightly wrong. So the algorithm cheated, basically. So we need to make sure. Oh, there's so we're also seeing this in if you have algorithms to do pricing, for example, uh-huh. have several competitors in industry, then it turns out that the algorithms, according to some researchers at the University of Bologna, they start colluding because they start realizing that they can keep the prices high, right? So doing what humans do,
cartels,
in back rooms, but they can do it through algorithms. So again, there are all these dangers that we don't really know enough about yet. So it has to be like medicine. First, do no harm. We need a Hippocratic oath for companies if they do anything with machine learning, and we need lots of external advisors. At SAP, we have a whole team of external ethicists and university professors and other people that help advise us that as we implement machine learning, because it's a fantastic opportunity, but as we do it, we have to be aware that it can have some downsides. That was number five. Number six, personal data sovereignty. This is one that I care a lot about. A lot of the problems that we've been talking about are based on really bad business models, basically clicks for eyeballs and fake clicks. There's a huge amount of fakeness in this whole industry. If we had a proper business model where I could pay somebody a micropayment for each newspaper article I look at, for example, rather than having to quote unquote pay through ads, or if I could be very selective about which data I share with whom, that would be actually much better. It would be a nice virtuous circle rather than the negative circle we've got right now. So there are these frameworks called self-sovereign identity. It looks like it's really the second area where blockchain really could be the breakthrough. So blockchain is essential for electronic currencies, cryptocurrency, and it's proven its value there. In other uses of business, there's lots of opportunities, but none of them have really panned out and or really require blockchain technology. Whereas this area really could be a breakthrough where I own all my data and I decide very selectively who gets what. So, for example, somebody might need to know that I'm more than 18, and that's it, right? I could subscribe to a magazine without them knowing anything about me other than that they get paid, right? That's the kind of business model we really should have. Why should everybody have to care about who I am in order to let me have access to a subscription? So that's a great model, and it's not a new topic. I signed up to OpenID a decade ago or something, but it just hasn't proved practical. But that one is huge, and it really will change every aspect of the industry that I care about, data and analytics. Number seven, surveillance society. I tried to keep some of these positive. The good news is in China, you can pay just by putting your face in front of a machine in the local, you know, Kentucky Fried Chicken. Uh-huh. And I can unlock my iPad just by looking at it. These are good things. But what's happening to all that data behind the scenes? And unfortunately, history of technology shows that absolutely every technology that was capable of being abused was abused. And most of the time, we didn't find out about it until many years later. So these kinds of abuses, unfortunately, are going on right now. I am absolutely sure that there are senior politicians around the world that are being blackmailed and compromised right now. And we're only going to find out about it in a decade's time, unfortunately. So this is something we need to care about. And it's going to get worse before it gets better because of quantum computing and quantum decryption. So our encryption today depends on factorization. It turns out that Shor's algorithm and Grover's search, I don't know much more about them other than their names, but basically quantum computing can use these to decrypt all of the information that exists in all of the databases in the world today. So the rumor has it that countries around the world are already stockpiling vast amounts of encrypted data, confident that they will be able to decrypt it in 5 or 10 years using quantum computing. And researchers are working on new forms of cryptography. So this is the P versus NP problem in mathematics. You want something that is NP, easily verifiable. Right? Yeah. Once you know the factors, you can tell whether they're factors of a number. But it has to be, we don't want it to be P, easily solvable. So there's something called lattice-based cryptography that we think is a big opportunity for better algorithms to protect data. But it's the forefront of mathematics, so we don't really know. It could be that somebody turns up tomorrow with an algorithm that shortcuts all of that protection. Again, something that we need to be concerned about. Eighth, team artificial intelligence. This is a fun one. Again, good sides, bad sides. So basically, think about generative adversarial networks, GANs. So these are used a lot in the creation of fake images, for example.
Okay.
A technology disruption. You'll never have to hire a model today because NVIDIA has open-sourced the algorithms for creating entirely fake faces that look perfectly real. So you can basically just choose the what type of face you want, and it will generate a beautiful image for you. Why pay for a real person? And it does that by two sets of algorithms. One algorithm is trying to create realistic faces. The other algorithms are trying to detect fake faces. So you just let them fight off against each other for several billion iterations until you get something that is very, very realistic. So that is huge potential. Again, we can, in business, we haven't used these GANs very much yet, but massive potential to really perfect different processes. Very powerful. It's also the technology that was used by DeepMind to win at Go and so on. Yeah. Basically, they had a tournament between all of the different algorithms. So they use algorithms to generate hundreds of thousands of algorithms, then let the algorithms fight against each other for the top algorithm to be better than all of the others. We're starting to see that in warfare. A couple of years ago, there was a project done with dogfighting, aerial dogfights.
Oh, yeah.
And genetic fuzzy algorithms. And once they'd actually generated the algorithms, they could be run on a Raspberry Pi computer, $35 at the time. And it beat all of the human fighter pilots. First as individuals, but then once you put as a team, so if you allow the algorithms to control five planes, then they were just completely unbeatable because they were able to use the five chains, the five planes in a form of 3D aerial chess, right? So they would deliberately fire to miss, knowing that the human reaction would be to go off in a certain direction, and then they'd be boxed in by the other planes. So teams, we've talked about the power of artificial intelligence, but the teams of artificial intelligence working together or against each other or networked, as businesses invest in AI and how those AIs talk to other AIs and collaborate, that's going to just be mind-blowing. And that's where we start maybe not being able to keep up.
I, for one, welcome our new AI overlords.
Yes, exactly. One fun aspect of this is, as you probably know, we sponsor a video team, a video game professional team called Team Liquid, one of the winningest in the tournament circuit. They millions of dollars they win every year, and they're some of the top players at Dota 2, that's Defense of the Ancients 2, and StarCraft. And again, they've been recently pitted against teams of artificial intelligence algorithms that came up with entirely new ways of playing the game. Yeah. Now, the result is the human players got better at playing the game, so augmented intelligence, if you like, but it's also a great illustration of how we're really only at the early days of this. So that brings me to point nine. We're at the start of a new golden age for knowledge workers. So the industrial age meant that a single individual could do way more than any individual could ever have done in the history of time before that. So a single person with a tractor could do hundreds of acres instead of just one with a mule. Now, knowledge work has been, the age of computers has helped with knowledge workers, but now we're going to see an explosion of that, basically, that a single individual with the right ideas can now control massive infrastructures. The cloud is part of this, right? It used to be that you have to be a big company to have access to big computing resources. Mm-hmm. But now you don't have to be a big company to have a big vision. Using the cloud, you can sign up for a cloud infrastructure on the fly, pay as you go. You're really not limited at all by what you can do. Like one person can access exactly the same computing power as General Electric or Unilever. Now, that really is going to transform the power of individual people to do amazing things. That brings me to the last and final point, which is this is going to change society again. It's great that individuals are allowed to be enabled to do amazing things. But it gets back to the fundamental problem of society is what if that person that has malaria in Africa is the person that would otherwise cure cancer. How do we take these opportunities that are just amazing and make sure that they're shared to make the world a better place rather than increasing disparity across different regions? Again, if it were easy, we would have done it by now.
Yeah.
But hopefully working together. Again, it's just a call out for all of us who work in this industry to just now and again step away from helping businesses to make more money and so on and really work on how we can use that technology to make everybody better off. So those are my 10 points. What do you think?
Awesome. Really, really good. You raise a lot of interesting points. And I think you're right. There's a lot of potential downside to the huge potential upside that we need to be aware of, and we need to make sure it doesn't become an actual downside rather than a potential downside. I'm by nature I'm a glass half full person, so I tend to see our progress in the same way I see. I don't know if you're familiar with the Keeling curve. The Keeling curve is the graph of CO2 over, you know, the last X number of decades. And it's a sawtooth, you know, kind of up and down every year seasonally. And that's kind of the way I see our progress as well. You know, it's kind of two steps forward and one step back very often. And I think, yeah, we will have issues with some of these things, but we'll fix them and we'll move on and we'll get better. That's it.
So basically, I mean, when people say, well, is this technology good for society or bad for society? Right. The headline writers like writing that this is bad for society. Uh-huh. And then the industry likes writing this is good for society. But the answer is, of course, every technology is a powerful weapon. And like any weapon, it can be used for good or used for bad. So the answer is this technology good or bad is always it depends.
Yeah.
What does it depend on? It depends on us making the right choices on how to adopt and use that technology.
Yeah, correct, correct, correct. How do we make sure that it's used for the best?
Get involved, vote, follow us on Twitter.
Cool, cool. I think, Timo, we're running out of time. That's been a phenomenal 10 points you raised out there for us. Any final point you want to make before we call out a podcast?
No, I think I'm good. Just share your thoughts. If any of that has intrigued, if you know any good solutions that you could recommend, let me know.
Awesome. That's great. Timo, thanks a million for coming on the show.
Thank you.